we're happy to welcome you here to Pine Hall at the BSO School of Music, where we are honored and privileged to work, teach, and play every day on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded lands of the Squamish, the Tsleil-Waututh, and Musqueam Nations. And tonight, we're thrilled to be hosting the Caili O'Doherty Quintet, fresh from New York City, and with many thanks from the support from the American Consulate to Angela and Shireen and Helena, and we're very happy to have the American General Consul General, Mr. Brent Hart, and his wife, Mrs. Saskia Hart, here tonight. So welcome to you. The mic is at the right height, but the stand is too far away. Anyways, I'll just give you a quick explanation of how the evening is going to progress tonight. So first, we're going to watch a short film describing the project of the Caili O'Doherty Quintet, celebrating Lil Hardin Armstrong. This project was made possible by a grant awarded to the quintet by the Chamber Music America Presenters Consortium for Jazz, in partnership with the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, the New Orleans Jazz Museum, and the Alabama Women in Jazz Festival. And after the film, we'll enjoy a short performance by the quintet, and that will be followed by a panel discussion and a Q&A session. Then we'll have an intermission, followed by a full set by the quintet, and then we'll be joined on stage by VSO School of Music Big Band, led by Dan Herzog. Thank you, everyone. So thanks for coming. Have a wonderful evening, and let's start the show.
My name is Caili O'Doherty. I'm a pianist, composer, arranger, and band leader, and this is my project, Celebrating Lil Hardin Armstrong. Lil Hardin Armstrong was born in 1898 in Memphis, Tennessee. She was raised by her mother and her grandmother. Her father died when she was young. And she grew up with an organ in the house, and she loved to play the piano from a young age. Lil's first professional experience with music would be playing in church. I believe she got paid to do that when she was young. And then she started playing as a sight reader or a music demonstrator when she moved to Chicago with her family around the age of 15. She would read sheet music for people, and there's a great interview of her where she talks about Jelly Roll Morton coming in and demonstrating some music and showing her how kind of confident and heavy, as she says, he would play the piano, and it inspired her greatly from a young age. She discovered jazz music at a young age, and her mother and grandmother were very upset that she was interested in learning more about jazz music because it was seen as the devil's music. Lil got a job playing at a cabaret when she was about 15 or 16 years old, and it was a very late gig. I think it started around 1 a.m. and her mother was mortified about this. She found out 3 months after she had started performing with this group in Chicago. Lil Hardin was an incredible composer. She also wrote lyrics, she was also a singer, and she also was an amazing piano player. She had many, many facets to her musicianship. But something that stands out the most to me about her music is her compositions. She had such a unique style of writing for the time. It was very expressive. She has little embellishments and details in the music that make it have character. And that's what separated her from her peers. She stood out because she fought for what she wanted. When she wanted to get that job as a sight reader at the music store, it was because she wanted to learn all of the music they had. She wanted to practice the popular music of the time that her mom didn't want her to learn. And at first when she arrived, they said, "Oh, you're just a little girl." But she said, "Can I try?" And they let her, and after she played, they gave her the job anyways. Lil Hardin met Louis Armstrong through King Oliver, Lil Hardin was playing in King Oliver's band for a good period of time before King Oliver sent for Louis to come from New Orleans to Chicago to play with his band. And she, when she first met him in an interview, she says she didn't think anything about him. She thought he was just another musician from another city. But then King Oliver made a comment saying that Louis Armstrong was actually a better trumpet player than he was. And she said then she started to listen for what made him stand out. In Louis Armstrong's Hot Five group, Lil composed many of the compositions that were made famous by his group, like Stromus of Barbecue, Two Deuces, and Don't Jive Me, which happened to be some of the compositions we're performing. I had heard about Lil Hardin when I was in college at Berkeley in a class about Louis Armstrong in relation to the Hot Five group, and I was very curious about learning more about her music. She was not someone that came up very often in my studies. Several years ago, I did my master's degree at Queen's College and I took a class on Louis Armstrong, and Lil Hardin came up again many, many times, not only in the context of the Hot Five group, but also in the context of transforming Louis Armstrong's career. She made a lot of sacrifices to her own career to push his career and to help him succeed. One of those ways was by having him quit King Oliver's band and go out and network to create his own group. I wanted to learn more about her, so I started digging in the Louis Armstrong archives at Queen's College, and I found a bunch of original charts, sheet music that she had written, and several of the songs were compositions that I had been taught were Louis Armstrong's compositions, but they actually had her name on it, her handwriting. And I was curious to know more about that, as she's one of jazz music's most underrepresented women. Many people have recorded Lil Hardin's music over the years. One of her songs, Just for a Thrill, was recorded by Ray Charles and Aretha Franklin. It says a lot about her as a composer that her music transcends different genres, and that musicians in more popular time periods, as it evolved, were able to modernize her music even though it was written many years before. My goal was to modernize Lil Hardin's music in a way that paid homage to her contributions to the music world, and also to give recognition and some context for people to learn more about her music and her life. This project has been a dream of mine for several years, and I am so excited for you all to hear the music. Hope you enjoy the show. Tahira Clayton on the voice. This is Cory Cox on the drums. Adi Meyerson on the bass. My name is Caili O'Doherty. We're the Caili O'Doherty Quintet. Tell you that first song we played was a composition written by the great Lil Hardin Armstrong. It was called Let's Call It Love, and it was an arrangement that I did for a project that you all saw a little bit about today. It's my project called Celebrating Lil Hardin Armstrong, and we are going to play one more tune for you of Lil Hardin's, and this is called Riff in the Blues, and then we're going to open it up for a panel discussion, a little bit about Lil Hardin's life and some other questions that we have prepared. So we hope you enjoy Riff in the Blues, and then we'll be back for a short panel. Thank you.
They're going to reset the stage for us, and we'll be right back for the panel. Yeah, just a second. Well, I got my master's degree at, we're all from New York. Well, no, we're not from New York, but we live in New York now, actually. I was gonna mention that we have two of our bandmates are from Texas. We have Houston and Dallas. Yes. Adi is originally from California, but she grew up most of her life in Israel. And Roxy is from Seattle, nearby neighbor here. And I'm from Portland, so also nearby neighbor. So when I moved to New York, I studied at the Queens College, and they have the Louis Armstrong archives there. So I think you heard a little bit about that, but that's how I got interested in her. But she was it's a kind of a common phenomenon in jazz history for women musicians, especially instrumental women musicians, to be kind of go unrecognized, where we don't really learn about them in our history. And so this is a reoccurring theme that had happened many times. She was just a very key figure in shaping jazz music. So that is why in particular I thought of her. But there are many other women that we should be highlighting besides Lil Hardin, in addition to Lil Hardin. So.
Great, and you got involved with the National Jazz Museum. How did that happen? Can you say more about that?
Yeah, so I got a grant through this organization called Chamber Music America, and the grant was to present three concerts with them. They were recorded at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, which is I've worked with them many, many times. They're good friends of mine, and so I asked them, would you all be open to having this live recording at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. I lived in Harlem for 9 years, 9 or 10 years. Actually, we all either live currently or lived in Harlem, so we have very strong Harlem ties here. And so we would always go to the Jazz Museum in Harlem. It was a place where even musicians, sometimes pianists, would go to practice. It's just like a safe space in the community that you could just go and hang out at. So I asked them, would you be interested in partnering? And so that's how it all came alive there. And it was really special too. I was kind of saying back there that it was cool to do a recording in a unconventional space. They brought in an engineer and we just kind of re-envisioned the whole recording process.
Whoops, sorry, what happened there? Apologies.
Check, okay.
So you're referring to the fact that in the film you can see there's cars driving by. That's actually at the museum, right?
Yes.
Where you were actually doing the filming.
And some of the audio we couldn't use because there was ambulances and stuff in the background. So that was funny because we're actually going to release this as an album soon, in about 6 months. We're going to release this project live at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, and the audio is just so funny. You hear the ambulances and fire trucks in the background. It's like, can't use
it's real life.
Yeah.
Okay, this is for anyone who'd like to answer. So Black History Month, as we all know, is February, and it's celebrated in the United States and in Canada. And I think it's fair to say that jazz is of course embedded in Black American culture, but it was a voice of resistance against the status quo to some certain extent. For anyone, is that voice still happening in jazz today? And how can we hear that? And how do we recognize that voice?
Well, I think first we need to clarify that jazz is Black American music, so it is Black American culture. It's not embedded in it.
Also, the wording of that, it didn't come out. But it's not partially because of what was happening at the time of enslaved people that were brought to the US. It only came out of that. Like, that's where it started. It came out of the blues. It came out as a tool for people to express, you know, their voices, people that were oppressed. Important to clarify that, I think, in the facts. And then the question was,
How do we recognize that voice? Can you talk about that?
I think
I'm gonna take it.
I think that the voice is within the creation. Like, I think the point that both of y'all are making is that Black American music is the voice, and you partaking in it and understanding that is the continuation of. It's not like a magic elixir, and we go poof. Now it's the voice, but I think the voice is the art that is created and that is pushed out. And if you can feel that, then yeah.
And so, freedom music, or however you want to approach stylistically, music within the style was always used to, like, when done right, was used to protest, and also be the voice for the oppressed. So to kind of answer your question, it's still like prevalent today. There's tons of musicians and artists in many forms that are using their voice in this music to be the voice for the people that don't necessarily feel empowered to speak. There's so many different art forms that come out of the lineage that is like genuine and rich to the culture. So everything that was done in the past time is still present and moving forward today. So there's so many different artists, like Aaron Brooks, amazing trumpeter, some more interviews. I mean, I can name all of my friends, but they're creating this protest freedom music to express. Yeah.
All of that. And also, it's a mode of joyful expression, too. And that's also very important, that these artists, as a form of resistance, or maybe just because they want to live joyfully, the art form covers so many things, which are all inherent to the history that you're talking about. Understanding of where it comes from, and then also understanding that it's also joyful expression. It's gratitude for what we have survived through. It's an offering to our ancestors. Like, it's so many things in addition to everything you said, too.
Do we have one more microphone?
Yeah. You can use mine. Here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, sorry, you only two.
Oh, and I'm going to use, can I use the sax mic as well? Would this work?
I wanted to add that all American music comes out of blues, and so, you know, when we're talking about, I feel like jazz music, Black American music is another term that is often used interchangeably with jazz music. When we talk about that, the blues influenced all American music, so country music, rock music, hip-hop, bluegrass. Any Zydeco, any American music came out of the blues. So it is all Black American music, really, at its core.
And, you know, we keep referencing the blues and jazz, and as Adi was saying, jazz came out of the blues and spirituals. But, you know, in terms of this question too about how is it happening today, I mean, we were playing the blues, riffing the blues, this Lil Hardin Armstrong tune, which was written probably 100 years ago almost, is still very relevant to us. And in terms of celebrating Black History Month, I think we all feel that we're celebrating Black history and Black excellence every time we play or paying tribute to that, whether it's a direct project like this where it's a Black musician composer or the music that we've created that is influenced by that and comes out of that same lineage. But in terms of playing the blues, you can hear that joyfulness that we hopefully we're presenting to you, but it's not just a sort of pure joy, right? Playing the blues, I think, is a complex thing that, you know, we think any jazz musician who's really taking the art form seriously and is a genuine jazz musician is portraying that sort of complex struggle, but also, you know, joy in the music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was created to tell stories and to express emotions, so whatever that emotion might be for you at the moment, just to tell your, as us as musicians participating in it, we're just here to tell our own stories while still honoring its tradition and its history and where it came from and the people that created it.
Okay, thank you very much. So if you guys want to say hi to the balcony up there, we've got a bunch of students.
Hey.
And you're going to hear from them later. I know a lot of you are teaching at jazz faculties in various places, so we'd love to hear from you. Three things. First of all, where are you teaching? That's very interesting. What's exciting you about emerging artists these days? And do you have a piece of advice you would give for these emerging artists here in the house?
Oh, you've got two mics.
Oh,
so I guess I've been teaching around New York in different organizations, mostly in position as like a teaching artist and touring artist. So just, I guess Jazz House Kids is one of them, Stanford Jazz Workshop, Jazz Reach, Jazz Lincoln Center. And I think one of the more important things while doing that is really having representation, and something that I noticed personally that, you know, that always touches me is when a little girl comes up to me and asks me, hey, can I also play the bass? Or like, I didn't know I could do that. And that to me means a lot because, you know, these kids see something and they see themselves in us and they see that we're doing something that they didn't think is possible that they can do. So that is really important to me. And I guess one piece of advice I would give you guys, I started with jazz pretty late in life. I started after I graduated high school. And I think I would just say, like, if you love it, just immerse yourself into it and give it everything, and the music will give back to you in the end.
So I currently teach at the Juilliard School, and I've taught, I do a lot of guest artist teaching around the world, and I've done other positions, residencies, etc. But I think that the thing that I love about the teaching work that I do is that no matter if I'm at Juilliard or a small school in the middle of the United States somewhere, I hear each musician brings their own voice to the music. And there's always something that you can add and that you can say that has never been said. And so that's very inspiring because you don't need to know a ton to make good music. You just have to be able to express yourself honestly in the moment with the right tools. So that's really inspiring to be around and hear young voices in this music. And I would say my piece of advice is similar to Adi's, but you are where you need to be right now. We always want to be at the end result, but actually jazz to me is something that is a lifelong commitment and a lifelong journey. And so you don't want to be at the end goal now, because then what's the point of the journey? You might as well quit if you're already at the end. So don't worry about, you know, being perfect. Just be where you are right now.
I actually want to start with my piece of advice because I feel like it's on, I'm about to forget it. My piece of it, someone said this recently and it stuck with me, that music is like a friend, like your best friend. It, like a kind of an escape, a therapeutic tool, you know, like a lifeline, something like that. And that really resonated with me through my life. The practice of music, of learning music, of being able to express myself, of being able to write music and practicing, the routine of practicing and dedicating yourself to something that you believe in and that you care about is such a beautiful concept. Like, every day you sit down and you're dedicated to something. I think that will forever carry in your life as a tool for, you know, coping with things that are difficult, or, you know, when you're not feeling inspired or you're going through a tough time. Music is, it's a tool of expression, especially jazz music. Jazz music is rooted in expression. And so for me, I think about it like that. And I encourage you to really lean into the idea of practice as a kind of a, like a routine thing that you can develop in your life. Because I think one thing I find, I teach a lot, and one thing that I find with young students is the art of practice and discipline gets lost sometimes. I know we're busy and things happen, but to show up for yourself time and time again is just something only you can give to yourself. And I really think that has completely shaped my life. So that's what I would say. And as far as where I teach, I am on the faculty at SUNY Purchase College in New York. And I also teach at a lot of Jazz Lincoln Center, leading educational performances on jazz and US history. We're gonna do a little bit of that tomorrow at Capilano University. Teach at many jazz workshops and guest artists and things around the world as well. But yeah, that's my piece of advice.
I'm going to also start with my piece of advice because it plays off of Caili's, which is, I so feel you. It's like, it is a meditation, it's a practice. You can really give yourself to it, and I encourage you to do that. And I also encourage you to play music together, because music, as much as it is a solo practice and a getting to know yourself practice and, you know, shaping your voice, it is also a music of community, and it does not happen without playing with each other. And I think when I was really young, that I had no shyness about that. That's what I remember about when I was maybe realizing that music was something really important or really big to me. I love to play with people. I love to go to the gigs. Like, I'm like talking 11, 12 years old. You know, little me like hanging out at the clubs with my parents and being like, I just want to sing. Like, I love to sing. I love to use, you know, so that passion. I'm just talking about myself now, but y'all get me. Y'all understand. All to say, I teach at a few places similar to Adi. I consider myself more of a teaching artist. meaning I get to go to a lot of different places and share my philosophy about teaching and create curriculum that specifically showcases that. And I love working with younger kids. I do not work with middle schoolers because they scare me. Middle schoolers are scary, it's hard. But I think there's something really important about teaching young kids about expression and about freedom and being able to do that through jazz and teaching Duke Ellington as, you know, we would teach about Mozart. Introducing more than just sort of this Western classical music ideology and learning music theory and music history, but really coming at it from a place of like jazz is all of those things and more. It can teach you basics and foundations and all of those things. So I work with babies and primarily at Brooklyn Conservatory of Music, I said, the Bloomingdale School of Music, an Upper West Side institution. These places have been around for 100-150 years, and then Trinity Music downtown, and it's great.
Your turn.
I'm sorry, what was the second part to that?
We had, where do you teach?
Where do you teach? That was the first
part. What's your thoughts about emerging artists these days, and one piece of advice?
Emerging artists. Okay.
You don't lose points or anything.
Yeah.
Come on.
We all like teach in a lot of the same places. So like Jazz House Kids, Jazz at Lincoln Center, who I've been fortunate to be a part of their educational program and travel the world and teach music. Also Stanford, and I hate like name dropping and all that, but also like teach privately. I think I just want to stress that I teach students, work with people of all different backgrounds. So whether in a public or private or a charter sector or whatnot, whether like in the second grade or you're like 82 years old, or, we all just want to like play and learn and grow. My thoughts on emerging artists, people are carrying the lineage, the torch, and pushing it forward, which is what I think, what Miles Davis wanted. As one of my heroes. I love to use him as a focal point. Like, take Louis Armstrong, Pops, and every other jazz musician. I think Miles was a cat that like took the music, ran with it, did his own thing with it, adapted certain things within the newer pop culture medium, and then like applied that to what his music was in that current time. So that is still evolving music today. So I'm like honored and like blessed to know that all of my peers and people that are younger than me and like, your age and whatnot are just like carrying the torch. And the last part of that, my advice, would be, I got into jazz, studying jazz because it was introduced as a way of expressing myself. I started playing music in church or different situations where you had to play music this way, this way, this way, play the verse, play the chorus, play this section, and it was like, let's do it like the record. And then I studied jazz, and you see that like a lot of cats, they'll be like, oh, let's play like the record or whatever. But you have that freedom to just express yourself. Now, my advice would be, don't be afraid to like get a little goofy. Don't be afraid to like study history. Sometimes music, sometimes older music, when you're studying history, can sound a little goofy or corny or whatnot. But like when you get comfortable like singing those melodies, like I'm probably the world's worst singer, but like adopting those melodies and just going forward and just like that freedom to just like be free, I feel like that saved my life because I felt like I was stuck in this little bubble and like jazz just opened me up to many different possibilities. So that being said, don't be afraid to study the history, study your lineage, but don't be afraid to go for what someone might consider wrong or like different. It's okay to be different.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for just one or two questions, if anyone has a question and would like to yell it out upstairs, downstairs. Any questions for the musicians? Oh, here's one here. Go ahead.
How do you get a hold of your album coming up?
Yeah.
Well, the latest album is called A Quarantine Dream. And
when did you record that?
You guessed it. 2020, March. Oh, not March 2020. No,
it's too early.
No, that's too early. No, I wrote the title track in March 2020 when I had COVID originally. We recorded it in June 2021, and then it came out June 2021. So that album is available. You can stream it or you can buy it. The newest album that we're going to release should be coming out in about 6 months, and if you follow my account on social media, I'll post when we're gonna release that. Everything for me on social media is just Caili Music, so Caili Music. That's it.
Okay, there's a question in the back there.
No, it's really a thank you. As a Black woman living in Vancouver, I really appreciate the allyship that's on stage as well as just in the production, right? My kids hate Black History Month because oftentimes they're like the only Black kid in class. Mm-hmm. And then when the teacher like speaks, then they'll come home and be like, everybody was staring at me. Everybody was asking me what I thought. And it's so tiring. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Sari. Caili, thank you for doing this. I really appreciate this.
Thank you.
Any questions from upstairs?
There's one thing I could practice. Well, first I want to say there's no right way to practice or thing to practice. Just doing it is the important part. Yeah.
No dark secrets.
No, I one of the things I realized when I moved to New York, I thought once I moved to New York City, like, okay, then it's gonna happen, right? And then I kept waiting, like, oh, at some point, you know, I'm gonna be a jazz musician or I'm gonna be great. Wait until now. Anyway, you'll see that. Anyway, but I realized there's no trick. There's no shortcuts. The only trick I realized when I would look up to my heroes, my mentors in New York City who were doing it as I saw, is that they hadn't quit yet. Just keep doing it. Don't quit. Recommit. Like, it's a friend, it's a relationship. Your saxophone is your friend, or whatever your instrument is. I know you play the saxophone. Just nurture that. It really doesn't matter. As long as the horn is in your mouth, you're doing the right thing.
That's a great note to end on. Thank you very much to the band. So we're going to have an intermission now, and we'll see you back here in about 15 minutes.
Thank you.
I'm really pleased this evening to be here at the beautiful Vancouver Symphony Orchestra School of Music and to help introduce, once again, our wonderful American jazz musicians, the Caili O'Doherty Quintet. Also, just would love to acknowledge that we are honored to be on the traditional lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. So, tonight's event, as we've all discussed, hope, and you can hear me, I'm getting a sound here, is in honor of Black History Month, celebrating the extraordinary contributions of African Americans to the United States and Canada. This celebration was started way back in 1926 as Black History Week. The celebration was the brainchild of an American historian, Carter Woodson, who himself looked forward to the day when the accomplishments of Black Americans would not just be celebrated in a week, but celebrated throughout the year as they are today. And having listened to some of the discussion earlier, I'll make a little riff of my own here to say that, you know, you really can't understand American history unless you understand how closely interwoven it is with Black history. It's not, Black history is not embedded in American history, as we talked about earlier. It is American history. And a recent project that has been doing some amazing work, the 1619 Project, notes that Africans arrived in what was then Virginia, the Virginia colony, way back in 1619. And if you want to understand anything about the United States today, many of our challenges, many of the you know, even issues in cities and so forth, you have to go back to that time that you know, we in the United States, this history, it's not a mosaic that you can separate out. It is deeply interwoven into our history. So I've seen throughout my diplomatic career just how much music connects people from different cultures in ways that really little else can. And I've been eager to bring an American jazz ensemble to British Columbia to share in this vital part of our history and to create new connections with our Canadian friends. So we are truly delighted to be able to bring to the VSO this evening the Caili O'Doherty Quintet, whose performance will bring to life some of this history through their very evocative and powerful music, as we've already had a taste. As we heard in the panel discussion, jazz emerged from a distinctively African-American sensibility in the aftermath of slavery as an outlet for expression and a mechanism for social change. It evolved during the era of Jim Crow, segregation, the civil rights era, and during decades of the stubborn persistence of ingrained racism. So jazz music really is inseparable from the African-American experience. Grammy-winning trumpeter Terrence Blanchard observed that what makes jazz African-American is the pain and suffering, the honesty about our search for truth. It's more than a musical style, but a genre rich in emotion, able to express pain, joy, or heartbreak. One of the most remarkable aspects of jazz is its syncretic nature that allows it to integrate influences from Latin America, Africa, Asia, and Europe to become an exceptionally diverse musical genre. In this way, it built and continues to build bridges between people of different races and ethnic backgrounds. Jazz bands were some of the first groupings to overcome racial barriers and bring Black and white musicians together. But it was still a struggle, attested to by an article a few weeks back in the Vancouver Sun that recounted an incident here in 1949 when the great Louis Armstrong, who we spoke about earlier, came to Vancouver to perform, and he was rather unceremoniously denied lodging at the Hotel Vancouver. And this ability to overcome racism that Armstrong, along with many other musicians, demonstrated really reinforces just how important it is that the pioneering contributions of African-American jazz artists are remembered and honored today. So with that, let me just say also, behalf of U.S. and Canada relations, you know, as friends, partners, and allies, the U.S. and Canada have always worked together, but we specifically agreed to work together in 2021 when President Biden came into office through something we call the Roadmap for a Renewed U.S.-Canada Partnership to actively fight against systemic racism, discrimination, and to promote diversity and inclusion, a commitment that our leaders recently reaffirmed at the North American Summit in Mexico. So with that, it is a privilege for me to introduce our visiting performers, Caili O'Doherty on the piano, Cory Cox on drums, Roxy Coss on the saxophone, Adi Meyerson on the bass, vocalist Tahira Clayton, all of them from New York City, as you heard, as part of the Department of State's American Music Abroad program. The quintet has performed around the world, Africa, Europe, and Latin America, and they've earned an amazing number of awards from the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers Jazz Awards. So please join me in welcoming the Caili O'Doherty Quintet back to the stage.
Hold on to him tight.
Signature tune entitled Tight. We're going to continue with another Lil Hardin tune. This is called Let's Get Happy Together.
Thank you.
one of the things I was most excited about was kind of checking out Canadian music, particularly Canadian Black music, or music created by Black Canadian musicians. And one of my absolute heroes, actually the first person that got me into jazz music, is Oscar Peterson, who is Canadian. And he, yes, you're a Oscar Peterson. And he has, I was kind of researching about anthems, because we're gonna play after this the African American national anthem, which is called Lift Every Voice and Sing, and I was wondering if there was an equivalent in Canada to, you know, like not the Canadian national anthem, but something specifically for Black Canadians. And people said time and time again, Oscar Peterson's song, Hymn to Freedom, this is like the anthem. So I am going to play that for you now. This is Hymn to Freedom.
Thank you.
Cory.
Thank you.
She always forgets to mention that part. You have to sing. That's thank you so much for hanging out with us tonight. It's our first concert of the run, so it's great to get to feel you out. Thank you, and get to know you, and getting to feel out each other too, which is beautiful. This is a tune that I wrote for my grandmother for my first album called Wait Till Now, and that's what the song is called. And so I'm from Texas. I think they mentioned that, from Dallas, Texas, but I was born in Louisiana. And when you live in Texas and your grandparents live in Louisiana, you go visit them during the summers. And my grandmother, she was very well known in our community for making meals for people, particularly on Sundays, which was church day. And it wasn't regular church day, it was four services Sunday. I think that's a very Texan thing, I think. Bye for you. It's a lot of church, and it's a lot of food too, and a lot of dishes, and I was the dish girl. And one Sunday, I'm nine, and I'm like, Grandma, I have a brilliant idea. Wouldn't it be great if I just waited until the end of the day to do all of the dishes? Because there was breakfast, right? You go to church. There's tea, you go to church. There's lunch, you go to church. There's dinner, you go back for night service. That's a lot of dishes. And she told me, in only the way my grandmother could, you're gonna wait till right now to go and do those dishes with your brilliant idea, little girl. So wait till now. That I didn't think about that until many years later when I was living in New York City. And I sort of heard this mantra after she had passed, and she had given me a song, and so I wrote it, and you're gonna help me sing it now. And it's very simple, it goes like this, sounds like, wait till now. It's very simple. Shall we try it, everybody? Are we ready? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Wait till now.
Wow! I thought Canadians would be more shy. I love it. That's strong. Shall we try one more time? Are we feeling, we're feeling confident now? What do you say? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Wait till.
I love it. So I'll let you know when it's your turn to sing, yes? Okay. Yeah.
In love, she pressed you in the sun. She said, wait till,
oh, you got it. You got it.
Oh, you're gone.
Whisper the word to the night. No pause for
to invite up the VSO School of Music and Mr. Dan Herzog, the conductor, Dan Major. We're just going to do a quick switch over, so feel free to talk amongst yourselves for a minute.
Yeah, you can. composer, arranger, and he came from a family, all of whom
were brilliant jazz musicians, Alvin Jones and Hank Jones, that made enormous contributions to this music. So we're thrilled to play one of his compositions for you. This is entitled 3-in-1.
Thank you.
opportunity to get to have a discussion and a dialogue with the audience before we play. We were all just backstage saying how special it is, and it impacts the way that we play music. So we are grateful for you for being here. We want to say a huge thank you to the US Consulate, Consulate General, and everyone who made this happen for Black History Month. We're very grateful to be here in Canada with you all, and looking forward to meeting some of you at the event after this. So thank you again. We really appreciate it. Thank you.